If you don't have a seat, we invite you to watch the event online on the UNFCCC website or on the COP platform. But please do not stand on the side of the Action Hub.
Well, welcome, good evening, welcome to you here at the end of this already long day, but we're going to make it a bit longer, but hopefully interesting and insightful, and welcome also to those who are watching online. I'm Bruno Giussani, I'm the lead curator of the Countdown Initiative, an initiative by TED and Future Stewards, who are represented by Lindsay Levin, my colleague here. It's a collaboration I started 2 years ago. We wanted to use the tools of TED, convening, digital video conferences, storytelling, and the tools of future stewards, leadership, and capacity to confront difficult topics and difficult conversations to bring out big solutions, big scale solutions to the climate challenge, to make them known, to make them circulate around the world, to make them accessible and to make them visible.
Yeah, so it's Countdown is a big collaboration. We've worked with a bunch of different fabulous civil society organizations, societies, businesses, entrepreneurs, innovators, activists, compiling solutions and turning them into different kinds of materials, including TED Talks. So I would say two things just by way of introduction. One is that it is an extraordinary collaboration, and part of the privilege of the work that we've done over the last couple of years has been working so creatively with people all over the world. And the second thing I'd say is that it's been a real joy on such a difficult topic to spend time looking at solutions, to spend time looking all across the world at what are people doing to actually solve this problem. And we're going to share a little bit of that with you this evening. We had a summit a couple of weeks back where we shared a lot of new talks. We shared many last year, and we're going to give you a little taste of Countdown. There's much more of this also that you can tap into after the event. So thank you for being with us tonight at the end of a long day, and thank you to all those who've joined us online.
So the theme of COP today was nature slash oceans. Tomorrow is going to be nature slash land. And it was also Youth Day. So we're going to talk about oceans, talk about youth, but also about technology and about us, about connecting with nature, connecting with others, connecting with our own deep being. So the first talk is about technology, but also about how do we look at the problem and how do we measure the problem? Because when a problem is big, unless we know how to measure it and we find a way to measure it, it's very difficult to tackle it. It currently takes literally months to get accurate readings, for example, of greenhouse gas emissions. Many of them are self-reported by countries or by companies. But technology is coming to help. There is a new system, a new initiative, which is seeking to get real-time measurements of greenhouse gas emissions. It's called Climate Trace. It has been discussed already within COP over the last couple of days. It was introduced a few weeks ago, was presented at TED Countdown. Here is the leader of that initiative, Gavin McCormick.
What is causing climate change? I mean, it's greenhouse gas emissions from human activities, of course. But which human activities? Who specifically is burning all these fossil fuels? And for what? And where? It sounded strange when I first heard it, but I have come to learn that even today in the 21st century, scientists have surprisingly little information about this question. So I'm part of a new coalition of scientists, activists, and actually tech companies working to address this issue. It's been a stranger journey than I expected. Let me break it down for you. So we've known for decades that emissions are rising in the atmosphere because we can see them swirling up around there. So the famous Keeling curve is based on what we can actually see from space. But what you can't easily see from space is how did they get there? It still boggles my mind, but even in the year 2021, in most countries and most sectors of the economy, our process for actually answering where all those emissions are coming from is still to ask polluters how much they polluted. Just kind of like hope nothing is missing in that inventory, and then add up all those numbers, sometimes manually on paper. It's amazing that every single country in the world has agreed to this process. It's one of the great things that brings me hope that everyone in the world is essentially contributing to this process. But it is such a stopgap solution. If we're really, really serious about stopping climate change, you can only manage what you can measure, and we need to have more information. We need to have information not like letting it take years to compile manual reports. I mean, there are countries that haven't had an emissions inventory in 20 years. What are you actually supposed to do with information that old? We need to not just be looking at what are the emissions of entire countries, because if you want to know how to reduce them, you need to know, right, do I need to go after the cars? Do I need to go after factories? What in my country is driving all these emissions? We can't keep relying on asking polluters to report how much they polluted. And there's even more subtle problems. Like, one that really gets me is if one company reports it's reduced its emissions, we don't have a good way to know right now, is that a real reduction? Should we celebrate? Or did they just play hot potato and sell something that pollutes to another company? If we want to get really serious about fighting climate change, we need better tools. We need to have some way to get information in, ideally, real time, not years later, that doesn't rely on just asking the polluters, that has really detailed information about where those emissions came from, not just country level, that is open and transparent so everybody knows they can trust it, and ideally that's free, because we can't just have a situation where only those who can afford to pay know how much is being emitted. So that's a serious scientific and engineering challenge. How exactly would you go about building a system like that? Well, you might want to start with a photo like this. We know, because this is one of the few power plants in the world that actually has a CO2 emission sensor in its stack, that at the time this photo was taken, it was emitting 2,930 tons of CO2 per hour. But we also know that a short time later, the same exact power plant looked like this. And at that time, of course, it was emitting 0 tons of CO2. I mean, you can see that with the unaided human eye. But often, it's a little more complicated. And so we have started to work as a cluster of small NGOs on training computer vision AI algorithms to look at hundreds of thousands of photos like this to recognize what a power plant looks like when it's polluting a certain amount of pollution from space. The reason we can do this is that there are so many free and public satellite images available now from sources like NASA's Landsat 8 or China's Gaofen 6. It's possible actually to get photos every few days of every major power plant in the entire world. And so my organization, WattTime, and a number of other small NGOs have teamed up to build an artificial intelligence algorithm that can scan visual imagery like this every few days and look without asking the polluters to see how much they are polluting for every power plant in the world. Pretty exciting. And so you can actually do better than that, because there are other forms of satellites as well. So just like in the movies, we can switch to thermal infrared, and we can look at whether power plants are hot as well. That matters because that's a completely independent assessment with different satellites and different techniques. So if those two methods agree, that's really encouraging we found the right answer. You can also look at information like downwind from a power plant a little while later. Do we see more emissions popping up in the atmosphere where they ought to be? You can even do really subtle things, like you can look at the cooling water intake valve near a power plant. Using commercial imagery from Planet, we are able to see ripples in a river near a power plant, and that means it's drawing in so much water because it's that hot and polluting. So no one of these techniques is perfect, but it's pretty remarkable how accurate they start to get when you combine many, many different independent techniques. And so we got pretty excited when we were starting to get pretty good results measuring all the power plants in the world. But then Al Gore, amazing as he is, encouraged us to dream bigger. And so we got the challenge from him and the partners of Generation to not just think small in terms of power plant emissions, but to see if we could do all human emissions from all major sources in the planet and make that available and free to everyone. And with their support and with a whole lot of teaming up with other organizations, collectively all of us have been able to do just that. So, a really exciting example of this is Transition Zero. So they're a UK-based organization that is able to monitor the emissions of steel mills, and they can do that even when those emissions are invisible to the naked eye. Because one of the really important, interesting things about artificial intelligence is with different forms of signals from satellites, we can look at very specific chemical processes in different parts of the supply chain. You also have the ability to measure factory farms. So did you know even the United States EPA, in charge of regulating them, does not have a complete inventory of how many highly polluting factory farms are in the United States? But a startup in Synthetic has been able to apply computer vision to build an inventory of them and is now scaling it up to expose every factory farm worldwide. RMI is monitoring oil and gas emissions from production and refining. Blue Sky Analytics, based in India, is monitoring crop fires and forest fires. You want to talk about car transportation? Johns Hopkins University is modeling all the ground transportation and looking at the road networks worldwide. Each one of our organizations has learned to specialize in one or two forms of particular emissions, but we're sharing them all in a giant database known as Climate Trace. So one of the really interesting things about Climate Trace is that it's fundamentally built on global techniques. So here you're looking, here you're looking from Ocean Mind's model of every single ship on the planet and the associated emissions. This is really powerful because it used to be the case that only rich countries can afford to look at their emissions in great detail. We are talking about properly global systems that are available and free for everyone. The reason, of course, we can do this is because satellites have come down so much in cost. There are now literally thousands of eyes in the sky up above us, and many of them are actually free and open to anyone to use that information. But you know what's come down in recent years even more in cost than satellites? Big data and AI. I mean, we now live in a world where if a certain meme is trending on Twitter, there are automated marketing algorithms that know that worldwide in minutes. We suspect there are stock market algorithms that know it in seconds. It's really useful for day traders. So we actually exist as a society spending more resources on monitoring funny cat video views on the internet than a civilization-threatening crisis. Something just seems strange about that. And so at Climate Trace, we decided to take a tiny, tiny fraction of those resources and those technical monitoring capabilities and reallocate them to actually monitoring emissions. So it's this giant shared database. I mean, we have software engineers volunteering their time on nights and weekends to make the data engineering work. We have academics validating algorithms. We have NGOs running different models. We have sensor and satellite data companies donating code. And much like Wikipedia, what's going on is all of these many, many different experts are sharing our resources in a single common pot that anyone can see. Everything has to be cross-validated, and it's available to the public. The biggest difference from Wikipedia is there's a lot more real-time sensors involved. So why are we doing this? In a word, transparency. We were approached early in the project by a former climate negotiator who told us that, look, the heart of the Paris Agreement is supposed to be that countries are able to see what everybody else is doing. They can learn to trust each other, and that's why they're willing to hold hands and leap together. But the problem is there's a lot of self-reporting going on, and a lot of countries don't have the resources to do this very expensive old form of monitoring. And so what we've tried to prioritize for Climate Trace version 1 is releasing before COP26, last month, September 21, a version of Climate Trace that is free and available to everybody that has the emissions for every country, every sector, and every year on the planet. So here we're looking, for example, at the emissions of rice production in Malaysia in 2020. Or Australia's electricity emissions in the same year. This is all available to anyone on climatetrace.org for free. Now it's a, thank you. Now it is imperfect. Artificial intelligence starts out not quite as good and it gets better over time. So far, one of the things we've been able to measure is what does this compare to what countries have been reporting? So we can't say that our methods are completely perfect yet, but one of the big questions we get is should countries trust each other? And one of the most surprising things I think I've learned from this project is that I think the answer is yes. I mean, we've definitely found some missing emissions. There are a few industries that we need to go have some hard conversations with. But by and large, what we've been really struck by is the vast majority of countries appear to have been able to get away with murder, but negotiating with each other in complete good faith. If you're a climate negotiator headed into COP26, I would like to just pause and appreciate what that implies for trust in what's about to happen. But I think it'd be a waste of AI if we stopped there. So our next step for Climate Trace version 2, what we're working on is making every single emitting asset in the world visible. So it's going to look like this, and what that's going to mean is not just national totals, but giving tools. I've spoken with governments that are interested in knowing where in our economies are the emissions coming from. I've spoken with companies who'd like to green their supply chains, but they have to know which factories are cleaner than which other factories. I've spoken with asset managers who are investing $43 trillion in net zero, but to actually achieve their goals, they need a way to manage and measure, are those emissions reductions really happening? So I think it's pretty exciting that we can now ensure that if anybody in the world is trying to hide emissions, they can just forget about it. Those days are over. Thank you. But the part that really excites me the most is giving tools to others in the climate fight to get the job done faster. Thank you.
So exciting. This is the stuff we need to share with people. So another big idea that is really starting to get traction is less about how we track fossil fuel emissions, but rather going back up the supply chain and how we deal with stopping production. Our next speaker is the executive director of Stand.Earth and the chair of the Fossil Fuel Non-Proliferation Treaty. I'm delighted to introduce Tzeporah Berman.
Canada's great northern forests, they're the place of my heart. They hold 25% of the Earth's wetlands, and they're the nesting and breeding ground of the majority of North America's songbirds. They're the traditional territories of hundreds of indigenous nations. And my climate journey started here as a forest activist a long time ago. I was horrified that Canada's old-growth forests are being logged. They're burning. They're being destroyed by beetle infestations. But also because so much of the forest is under threat because of what lies under it. Oil. At the time, I thought that Canada's failure to reduce emissions was because we had a government that just didn't believe in climate change. But then, in 2015, we elected a new government. And Prime Minister Trudeau came to Paris, and with his hand on his heart, he said, Canada's back. And he went home to introduce some really good climate policy, carbon pricing. And our emissions didn't go down. And the government continued to greenlight and even subsidize new oil sands, pipelines and fracking. And that, for me, was the moment when I realized where one of the big problems lie. Our governments are regulating emissions, but not the production of fossil fuels. You see, climate policy and agreements, they're complicated. But what's simple is that the majority of emissions that are trapped in our atmosphere today, well, they come from three products: oil, gas, and coal. For decades, our countries have been negotiating targets. But behind our backs, the fossil fuel industry has been growing production and locking in further emissions. I started reaching out to climate policy experts from around the world, because I wanted to understand what frameworks exist to negotiate who gets to produce what and how much. What policies help governments regulate, constrain the production side of fossil fuels? I found out that very few do. I will never forget the day that I sat with the Paris Agreement and I searched for the words fossil fuels, oil, gas, coal. They didn't appear. Not even once in the world's climate agreement. The fossil fuel industry has been successful in making itself invisible. I started reaching out and met with, for several years, the CEOs of major oil companies because I wanted to understand, what do these CEOs see when they read the science? How can they justify expanding oil and gas at this moment in our history? And also because I believe that there are good people everywhere. There are good people stuck in some bad systems. What I learned is that they know. They know that we're going to have to wind down fossil fuel production. But they are all holding out hope that they will be the last barrel sold. Or that unproven technologies like carbon capture and storage will allow them to continue to increase production. The problem is, the math just doesn't add up. We are currently on track today to produce 120% more fossil fuels in the next decade than the world should burn if we want to stay below 1.5 degrees Celsius. In fact, even if we phased out coal overnight, oil and gas in existing projects would take us beyond 1.5 degrees. For decades, climate policy has been designed on a theory that we're going to reduce demand, that the price of carbon is going to go up, and the markets, turbocharged by alternatives, wind and solar, now cheaper than fossil fuels, well, the markets are going to constrain supply. The problem is, it's not happening. Not fast enough to keep us safe. Why? Because the markets today are distorted. They're distorted by tax breaks and fossil fuel subsidies, but also because of the power of the fossil fuel industry, the influence of the industry, who no longer deny climate change, but they have moved from denial to delusion. That technologies that are not yet proven at scale, that are not yet cost competitive, are going to fix it in the future. I've spent 30 years running environmental campaigns. I've advised multiple governments on climate policy. I've been arrested on the blockades, and I've negotiated in the boardrooms of some of the largest banks and corporations in the world. And when I figured out that we don't have a framework for constraining the production of fossil fuels, I thought I was crazy. And so did some of my colleagues. But here's the thing. Today, we are granting permits. We are spending trillions of dollars to increase the production of products that we say we're transitioning off of. It's not a transition if we're still growing the problem. We have more than enough fossil fuels in existing installations, even if we stopped expansion today, of oil, gas, and coal in existing projects to use while we carefully manage a phase down. And so the world is spending its intellectual, its financial, its technical capital to dig up stuff that we know we can't burn. And if we do, it will burn us. So what do we do? A year ago, a group of academics, advocates, scientists, and former diplomats came together to create the Fossil Fuel Non-Proliferation Treaty Initiative, to create the missing framework so countries can negotiate a wind down of fossil fuels in a way that is fair, in a way that is equitable. Shockingly, one of the things we found out is that we don't have accounting or transparency right now on who's producing what and how much. So work is now underway to create a global registry of fossil fuel production and reserves. We are also at work creating the principles of equity that have to underlie a treaty. Because the challenges to stop the expansion of fossil fuels in some countries are going to be so different than in other countries. There are countries today in the developing world, like Ecuador, that are drilling for new oil in the heart of the Amazon just to feed their debt. So no, we cannot rely just on the markets to constrain fossil fuel production. If we do, it will be an unmanaged decline instead of a managed decline, and more people will suffer. We need financial leadership at this moment. We need divestment at this moment. But we can't let governments off the hook. The wealthy countries need to act first. That means Canada and the US and Norway can't do more oil drilling and fracking and new pipelines. It means that the UK cannot call itself a climate leader right now and build the Cambo oil field. So here's the good news. Support for the treaty is growing. Every day, I'm so excited to turn on my computer. 101 Nobel laureates, including the Dalai Lama, have endorsed the principles of a fossil fuel treaty. Cities from around the world are passing motions at their city councils to endorse a fossil fuel treaty. Sydney, Barcelona, LA, Vancouver. Over 100 elected officials from around the world, from 20 countries starting in the Global South, have endorsed the principles of a fossil fuel treaty. Over 2,000 scientists have now endorsed the principles of a fossil fuel treaty. Indigenous leaders, youth groups, over 800 civil society organizations who have been fighting fossil fuel projects for decades are now calling on their governments to negotiate a treaty to keep it in the ground. Some of the criticism we get is that it's too big, it's unfeasible, it'll take too long. But the same was erroneously said about weapons treaties. For me, the answer is we don't have time for more of the same. We know that oil-producing nations are not likely to embrace a fossil fuel treaty. But what we've learned from studying landmines, what we've learned from studying nuclear, is that the journey matters. Just proposing a fossil fuel treaty is creating new conversations and new climate ambition. A fossil fuel treaty will help us wind down the production of fossil fuels. It will provide a complement and help us achieve the goals of the Paris Accord. It is a big, bold new idea. But at this moment in history, we need some big, bold new ideas. In 2021, millions of people lost their homes. Thousands of people lost their lives as the fires and the floods and the heat waves swept our planet. I know that this can seem overwhelming, but we are capable of enormous change in our lifetimes. I had a conversation with my grandmother once when I was out of hope, feeling overwhelmed. And she said to me, "Do you understand how much the world has changed in my lifetime?" She said, "When your mother was growing up, we didn't have cell phones or computers. We had a phone on the wall. It was a party line. When it rang twice, it was for us." She said, "I didn't know anyone who'd ever been on a plane." She told me that the world had entirely changed in her lifetime. She said, "How we travel, how we communicate, and it will in yours as well." So when I do this work every day for a fossil fuel treaty, I'm holding on to the idea that one day I'm going to be sitting with my grandchildren. I'm going to be telling them about this time in our history when we clawed at the last primary forest to get at the oil. This crazy time in our history when we used to fill our cars with gas, heat our homes with gas. And they will barely believe me, because the world will be such a different place. Thank you.
I saw Tzeporah yesterday, and she told me that some of those figures in the talk are already outdated because they've got more and more support from members of parliaments around the world, from other cities, and so. Now, we have a third video, and then there's going to be the first live interview of the evening. And the video is about what we in the climate space call the hard-to-abate sectors: cement, steel, aviation, maritime shipping. Big container ships are central to our economy, to the globalized economy. They also burn a lot of very dirty fuel. And it's also a sector where the biggest company is showing the most interesting leadership. And here to tell the story is the chairman of that company, Jim Snabe.
A few months ago, my daughter asked me a very simple question. Who are your heroes, Dad? I said, well, besides my father, hoping she would get the hint, one of my big heroes is Malcolm McLean. I realized that Malcolm McLean is not really known on social media today, but in 1955, McLean invented a metal box that changed the world, the shipping container. That invention reduced the cost of shipping cargo by more than 90%, and as a consequence, global trade increased 200 times and lifted hundreds of millions of people out of poverty by connecting them and their goods to global markets at very, very low cost. I'm sure McLean's invention started with a big dream to transform the transportation industry, and I know it took a lot of attention to details to change all of the equipment of all of the transportation companies worldwide to benefit from this container. To me, that is what leadership is all about. Dreams that inspire people to pursue opportunities that may seem impossible, and details. Because without attention to the details, the dream will just stay a dream. McLean's dream was to transform the cargo transportation industry by making it affordable. It is time to transform it again. We urgently need to make it sustainable. More than 9% of CO2 emissions globally come from transporting goods around the world. So, what is the dream? In 2018, the management team of A.P. Møller - Mærsk, the global shipping company I lead as a chairman, made a commitment to make the company carbon neutral by 2050. For some people, 2050 sounded like a long time into the future. But in fact, this was a very ambitious dream for a shipping company. To be carbon neutral by 2050, we needed to invent a zero-carbon container vessel by 2030. Because then it would take roughly 20 years to replace all of the 750 vessels that we operate. So the dream was truly big and really inspiring. But to be honest, in 2018, we did not know how to do this. We had to work hard on the details. Now, at that time, we had already focused a lot of attention on reducing CO2 emissions from shipping. In fact, we had achieved more than 40% reduction per container moved since 2008. That was done by building bigger and more efficient vessels and by slow steaming, which means sailing the vessel slower so it consumes less fuel. But we were reaching the limit. Obviously, you could sail so slow that you don't sail at all and you would save all of the CO2 emissions. but that didn't seem like a good solution. Now, some of the first humans who sailed the big oceans, the people from Polynesia, had figured out zero-carbon shipping by using sails. And it is true that sails can reduce the fuel consumption somewhat, but it cannot deliver on the efficiency and accuracy needed in today's global supply chains. Another alternative is batteries. But for the large vessels sailing the big oceans, the batteries would take up 60% of the capacity of the vessel. Some shipping companies started ordering vessels based on LNG, liquid natural gas. But LNG is a fossil fuel. It will never lead to zero carbon shipping. Slow steaming, sails, batteries, LNG, none of it would make us be carbon neutral. So what else? Well, we knew we had to look for other solutions, and we realized we couldn't do it alone. To help us find a solution, our main shareholder, the A.P. Møller Foundation, donated 400 million Danish kroner to create a global center for zero carbon shipping in Copenhagen. That center would bring together companies and specialists from all over the world, not just from the transportation industry, but also from energy, from chemicals, and engineering. And now, less than 3 years after our big dream, we have found a solution. It is called Power to X. Now, Power to X is not a new technology, nor did we invent it. It is a combination of known chemical processes to convert green electricity to a green fuel. First, you convert the green electricity from solar or wind to green hydrogen. That is done through electrolysis. And then the green hydrogen can be converted to various types of green fuels through chemical processes. The benefit of Power to X is that it produces a green fuel that is liquid at normal temperature and can be used in a combustion engine. So instead of spending 20 years to replace all of our 750 vessels and create a big pile of waste, we believe we can retrofit existing vessels by adding a combustion engine designed for green fuel. And with that, achieve zero carbon shipping much, much earlier. On top of that, Power to X is actually a very nice solution for one of the biggest problems in renewable energy systems, the storage problem. When there's too much wind and sun, you can convert the unused electricity to a liquid green fuel that can be used in many different industries. So, what are the challenges? Well, I often hear the same concern when it comes to sustainability. Can we afford it? And yes, it is true that this green fuel is more expensive than the bunker fuel we use today. In fact, it is 2 to 3 times more expensive with current technology. Like always, we need to scale these solutions to get the cost down. But even if the green fuel would be 2 times more expensive than the bunker fuel, it should not be a showstopper. Come on! Even at that price, a pair of sneakers transported from Asia to the US or Europe would only cost 5 cents more. So for me, the argument around affordability is just a bad excuse for not making the necessary decisions and investments. And if we had a price on CO2, let's say around $150, the affordability argument would disappear. I urge governments to show leadership and implement a global price on CO2 now. Because with that, we could focus all of our attention on the real issue, which is not the price, but the scale. At Maersk, I asked the following question. How much green electricity do we need to fuel all of our 750 vessels with green fuel? Our fleet today consumes 10 million tons of bunker oil. To replace that with green fuel, we estimate that we need 220,000 gigawatt hours of green electricity. That is the equivalent of 10% of the installed base of solar and wind in 2019. And Maersk is 20% of the cargo shipping industry. So to fuel the cargo shipping industry alone would consume 50% of the entire installed base of green electricity. And that's just cargo shipping. In other words, we need a dramatic exponential scale of installations of solar, of wind, of hydrogen production, of green fuel production to solve this problem. We estimate that the total investment will be in the neighborhood of $2 trillion, which, granted, is a lot of money. But actually, it is the equivalent of 4 years of capital expenditure in the oil and gas industry today. I predict that for the next 10 years, the demand for green fuel will be significantly higher than the supply. Isn't that wonderful? Higher demand than supply normally means great business opportunities for everyone who chooses to participate. And it proves one of my key assumptions in today's world. It has become good business to invest in sustainable solutions. My conclusion is very simple. We have the technologies needed to create a sustainable future. What we need is leadership. Leadership to get us there faster. On the 1st of July, 2021, Maersk ordered the first vessel designed for green fuel. It will be delivered in 2023. Only 2 months later, we ordered another 8 large vessels and made our first investments in green fuel production. What seemed to be an impossible dream only 3 years ago is becoming reality now, 7 years ahead of the original plan. This is a leadership moment. It is time for us to pursue big dreams, even if they seem impossible. And it is time for us to collaborate around the critical details so we get to a sustainable future much, much faster. Thank you very much.
So I'm delighted to say that we have a surprise guest. 3 years ago, she gave a TED talk, a wonderful TED talk, making the case for informed, calm, generous conversations about the things that separate us, the things that divide us when it comes to climate change. She's turned that into a book, and she's here with us tonight. Please welcome climate scientist Katharine Hayhoe. Woo! Katharine, thank you so much for making time to be with us. And I know you want to share a little story about that talk, so please go for it.
I will. So my talk, which as you probably know, you have to memorize every word of. Somehow I missed that little fact when I first agreed to give a talk. My talk came out in December 2018. And in May, the following May, 5 months later, I was giving a series of talks around the London area. When I travel, I like to plan a dozen or more events in the same place so that when I fly, I stay one place and I do as much as I can in one place. So it was the end of a long day. I had started in the morning with a meeting with business people in the city, and I just finished a talk at the London School of Economics. I was walking back up the aisle, looking forward to putting my feet up and having a cup of tea, when an older man approached me and wanted to say hi. And he said, "I wanted to let you know that I saw your TED talk." I said, "Oh," he was actually one of the first people I'd met who had seen it, who I knew, who had come up to me, I should say. And he said, "Because of your TED talk, I started to have conversations in the borough of London where I lived. And I have a list of all the conversations I have had with people. Would you like to see it?" I said, "Of course, I'd never heard that before." So he reached in his bag and he pulled out this sheaf of papers. And I was expecting maybe 70 or 80 names. I mean, 5 months for one person to have conversations. Well, he hadn't just kept a record of his. He had kept a record of all the ones that they had and all the ones that they had. And he had 10,000 names that had had a conversation about climate change, why it mattered, and what they could do about it in their borough of Wandsworth. And because of that, their city council had voted to declare a climate emergency. And just before COVID, they put £20 million into a climate adaptation plan. That's the power of a conversation. And that's why when I did my TED Talk, I called it, the most important thing that you can do about climate change is what we're not doing, which is simply talk about it.
Well, speaking of talking about it, here we are, end of day for another long day here at COP26. Many conversations, difficult conversations, all kinds of conversations. What's your take, Katharine, at this point of the week?
Well, the conversations are such an important part of it. Because it's very easy to say, oh, this is what I'm doing here and now, when you're not looking into the eyes of someone who lives in another country where they have just had their crops destroyed because of a record-breaking drought, or where they have lost a significant part of land because of coastal storms or sea level rise. But when you're here and you're actually looking at someone,
right,
and you're having those conversations, or someone is literally knocking on your door asking if you will sign on to the methane agreement or to the end of coal, it's completely different because we are relating to each other as human beings. And so that's why when I wrote my book that came out of my TED Talk, it was just released in the UK last week, I didn't call my book Saving the Planet, because it isn't about saving the planet. The planet will still be orbiting the sun long after we are gone. What's it about? It's about saving us. Us humans and many of the other living things that share this planet with us. That's why we're here. And because of that, I truly believe that every single one of us already has every reason we need to care about climate change. If we're a human living on planet Earth. And if we don't think we care, it's simply because we have not connected the dots between what we already care about and how climate change is affecting that.
Now, your subtitle, I think, is A Climate Scientist's Case for Hope and Healing in a Divided World. Can you give us the... This is on my reading list, by the way, for the holidays. As soon as I get out of here, I've heard wonderful things about the book. Give us the quick, condensed summary of what you're doing with the book.
So often, we think that people just need more fear-based facts. If they're not worried, they should be worried, and we will load up our dump truck, so to speak, with all of the very true and accurate scary information that the science has, and I know because I'm a scientist, right, so I see this firsthand, and we will dump it on them. But here's the thing. I live in the United States where 70% of people are already worried about climate change. In the UK, in my home country of Canada, the numbers are about the same, mid-70s. Over to France, 85% are worried. Young people, 84% of people are worried. Mothers, 83%. We are already worried. What we are missing is not more fear. What we are missing is hope. Because when you ask people, how do you feel about climate change, the majority of people feel hopeless and helpless. And as Christiana Figueres said in the book that she wrote, The Future We Choose, she said, the biggest discovery that we made, imagining that we were in 2030 looking back, the biggest discovery we made was that we were only ever as doomed as we thought ourselves to be. And so what we most lack right now is that vision of a better future. We most lack a sense of agency, a sense of efficacy, a sense of hope. The idea that if I do something, will it make a difference? If we do something, will it make a difference? And the answer is it will. Because that giant boulder of climate action, it is not sitting at the bottom of an impossibly steep cliff with only a few hands on it. When we look around, that boulder is already at the top of the hill. It is already rolling down the hill in the right direction. It already has millions of hands pushing it down the hill. And if we add ours, and if we together add all of our hands, it will go faster. And that's what's needed right now, is just for that boulder to be going faster. And how do we start? We start by using our voice to share why it matters to us, why climate change matters to us here and now in ways that are relevant to our lives, where we live today, where we work, where we live, the people we know, the organization we're part of, and what we can do together to make a difference. Because as you just saw from these talks, the things that we can do are infinite. And actually, the next talk is going to be about something even completely different than what you've seen before, and is part of the solution too.
Thank you so much, Katharine, for your work, the work you do on the science, for starters, but then the work to really work with us on conversations, on hope, on the mindset shift that we need. Thank you so much for what you do in the world.
Oh.
And yes, please introduce our next speaker, a fellow climate scientist.
I would love to do that. So only a tiny fraction of the planet's land and oceans are protected. But what the science shows us is that at least 30%, both on land and in the ocean, needs to be protected to maintain the integrity of our ecosystems and the biodiversity on which all life depends, ours as well as that of all non-human species. So my own organization, the Nature Conservancy, who I serve as the chief scientist, and is one of the initiators of a coalition of countries, organizations, and people who aim to protect 30% of land and ocean by 2030. This initiative is called 30 by 30, and I am very happy to introduce one of the leaders in this organization, who is a conservationist and a Nat Geo explorer in residence, Enric Sala.
Thank you. Thanks, Katharine. Thank you so much.
When I was a kid growing up in the Mediterranean, I was fascinated by the underwater world that Jacques Cousteau showed us on TV. When he started filming in the mid-1940s, the Mediterranean shores were still full of large fish. But when I went to the sea to swim in the 70s, I saw none of that. There were sea urchins on a barren bottom, but I never saw a large fish. The industrialization of fishing after the Second World War put the latest nail in the coffin of Mediterranean marine life. I thought nature was lost. Until I started scuba diving in the Medes Islands Marine Reserve in Spain. 1 square kilometer fully protected from fishing and other damaging activities. I still remember that first dive in the reserve. As soon as I put my head underwater, I felt like diving into one of Cousteau's films. What was missing from the sea of my childhood was there. Groupers, sea bass, octopus, scorpionfish, seaweed forests. Just a few years of protection had allowed the sea to bounce back. I have seen this miracle happen in other areas across the ocean, like in Cabo Pulmo, Mexico, where local fishermen were so upset with not having enough fish to catch that in the mid-90s, they asked the Mexican government to create a no-take area, a national park in the sea. We surveyed the marine environment then, and the place was an underwater desert. When we returned a decade later, everything had changed. What had been a barren sea was now a kaleidoscope of life and color. We saw it come back to pristine in only 10 years. Including the return of the large fish like groupers, jacks, and sharks. And those visionary fishermen are better off now. From diving tourism inside the reserve and better fishing around it. But today, globally, only 7% of the ocean and less than a fifth of our land have been protected. That means that we have converted most of our planet into a tame environment, where 96% of the mass of the mammals is us and our domesticated livestock. Only 4% is everything else, from pandas to tigers to elephants. And we have removed over 90% of the large fish in the ocean in the last century alone. On top of the laws of nature, we have global warming. This summer of 2021 has seen some of the hottest temperatures in human history in places that one would expect to be cool, like Canada, Finland, and Siberia. This extreme heat kills hundreds of thousands of people and fuels raging wildfires, turning towns, forests, and grasslands into ashes, also killing billions of individual animals and trees and many coral reefs around the world. No place is safe anymore. unless we rewild our planet. If we are to prevent a global disaster, we need to do two things. As we know, we need to reduce emissions of greenhouse gases to almost zero. But we also need to draw down the excess carbon pollution in the atmosphere and in the ocean. How can we do that? To capture the excess of greenhouse gases, we need nature's help. Because trees, grasslands, peatlands, mangroves, kelp forests, and healthy oceans are the best and most efficient technologies to remove carbon from the atmosphere. And they already exist. As long as we protect them, they do the removal for free. The more biodiversity there is, the more carbon pollution it can absorb, the more it can help stabilize the climate. And biodiversity also gives us clean air and water, food, and protection from floods, storms, and even wildfires. The problem is that nature cannot keep up with us. The biodiversity that is left today is not enough to absorb our impacts any longer. That's why in 2018, I put together a team of top scientists and economists to answer the question of which areas in the ocean we must protect first. And how much of the ocean do we need to protect? We decided to focus on three objectives: biodiversity, food, and carbon storage to help mitigate climate change. If we think of each objective in isolation, there are trade-offs. Protecting the top areas for biodiversity could result in a loss of fishing catch, for example. To solve that problem, we developed a new framework to optimize multiple benefits. Picking which areas to protect depends on how much we value the different objectives. We found that if we gain the same weight to each biodiversity, food, and carbon, we would want to protect the right 45% of the ocean to maximize the three benefits. We also found that even if we didn't value biodiversity, the minimum amount of ocean we would protect would be 30%. So 30% of the ocean is the floor, the minimum area that we need to protect if we want to preserve marine life and all the benefits it provides for people. Similar analyses have been done for the land, also showing 30% as a minimum. Armed with this research, we at National Geographic partnered with the WWF Campaign for Nature and launched a campaign for 30 by 30, meaning at least 30% of the planet, land and sea, protected by 2030. Working with the governments of Costa Rica, France, and the United Kingdom, we built a high ambition coalition for nature and people, which now has 66 countries in it and growing, all supporting 30 by 30 as a main target for a global deal on nature. 30% of our planet by 2030. Only that amount of wild nature, together with a massive reduction in carbon emissions, will be able to get us back on track. And of course, we need to manage our activities more responsibly everywhere else. 30 by 30 will involve a combination of strategies, from national parks and marine protected areas to lands managed by indigenous peoples and local communities, which have been effective in preventing habitat loss, often more effectively than conventional conservation methods. Expanding recognition of the land rights of indigenous peoples is an effective and moral solution for protecting our world. And protecting the land can be done only together with the people living on it, like Canada is doing with its indigenous protected and conserved areas. Some will say, however, that we cannot afford to protect our natural world. Well, let's look at the numbers. A study has put the cost of protecting 30% of the planet at about $140 billion a year. That's only a fraction of the money that governments use to subsidize industries that pollute our air, waste our soil, and empty our ocean. We need to reverse the flow of that money from funding the destruction of our life support system to preserving it. The solution to the problem we have created has been here all along, I understand that the idea of protecting a third of our land and ocean may feel threatening to those who see only the short-term profits of their destruction. But I am hopeful, because I have seen with my own eyes how nature can recover in those marine reserves. And I have seen how the return of nature has helped people thrive and build a better life. We just need to give nature the space it needs so she can continue providing for us. Thank you.
Thank you, Enric. We have one more talk, one live interview, and then a short, very interesting surprise at the end. And the talk is about the force that has emerged over the last few years, literally in the streets of the world, on the fight about climate change, the youth movement. It has brought a new sense of urgency. It has brought many new dimensions that were missing in this conversation. We have countdown. We have worked with many young activists. We actually have a countdown youth council that has been advising us and working with us all through the initiative so far, and we'll continue. One of the members of the council is the next speaker from Bali, Melati Wijsen.
Do you remember when you were 12 years old? I do. I was on a mission, convinced that I could change the world around me. In 2013, together with my sister Isabel, I started a movement in Bali because I saw a problem that I thought had an easy solution. We wanted to do something about the growing problem of plastic pollution on our home island of Bali, Indonesia. Now, when I first started, I had never heard of the word changemaker or activist. Today, I introduce myself as a full-time changemaker and movement builder. But it was not always delivered with such confidence. There is this saying, if I only knew back then what I know today. Sounds familiar, right? I started full of passion and excitement, believing that I would achieve this change of making Bali plastic bag free before summer was over and the school year started. And everywhere I went, I was met with, oh, so cute, so inspirational. And yeah, I guess two little girls and a bunch of friends trying to make a difference is pretty special. But you know what? Cute wasn't really what I was going for. I slowly learned to build a team, to gather evidence, create campaigns, develop a movement, to stage beach cleanups, collect signatures, speak in public and meet politicians. The more I learned, the more I wanted things to change. Passion quickly turned into obsession. And when change didn't happen as quickly as I expected, at 14 years old, frustration settled deep in my soul. And soon after that, in my first years of high school, I experienced my first burnout. But having said that, I wouldn't have changed a thing. Especially because in 2019, Bali finally did ban single-use plastic bags. My peers and I created our own learning journey outside of the traditional curriculum and classroom, building our own guidance and frameworks that could share with us what the next step should be, how to continue building the momentum we needed to achieve the change we wanted to see. I went through a lot of life lessons very quickly, and yet, there are things that I wish someone could have told me earlier, back when I was starting. First, change does not happen as quickly as summer vacation. It takes a long time, and that is not always easy to accept. But that is why it is essential to create a clear goal with a timeline. Also, it takes a lot of people. Listen and be open to learn, but stay true to the mission. And it would have also been so helpful to know how to navigate collaborations with businesses and politicians. Someone has to address the elephant in the room. And finally, it's okay to take a break and step back for a second. There are many of us on the front lines who will continue the work while you rest and recharge. Today, many of us are getting involved at a younger and younger age. 16-year-olds, 15, 14, 10-year-olds are out on the front lines, missing school, drafting manifestos, organizing demonstrations, bringing governments and corporations to court, refusing to wait until we are older to start making a difference. But being a changemaker is not something anybody has on their bucket list. It isn't something kids aspire to become when they grow up. It's something that just happens. Something activates you. An experience, an injustice that takes place, big or small, local or global. And then there is almost no choice but to get involved. In the last few years, I have spent more time in other students' classrooms than in my own, sharing principles of leadership, sustainability, and changemaker skills. And I can say with confidence that young people are aching for skills and knowledge that will allow them to act effectively today. Real change can start in the classroom, but the classroom has an increasingly distant relationship with reality. I think it is high time to ensure that what we learn in the classrooms reflect what is happening outside of them. And to ensure that every single student in every corner of the world has at least 1 hour a day of mandatory lessons about the climate crisis, the 17 SDGs, and about any sustainable innovations, about the realities of today's world, from kindergarten through to graduation. And I mean mandatory. I strongly believe that every young person can be a change maker, but often they need help knowing where and how to start. And while we wait for the classrooms to adapt, once again, my peers and I create our own learning journey. That is when I started a network called the Circle of Youth within Youthtopia, a platform for young changemakers to learn from each other. We need role models and positive stories with an impact, real life examples of how we can take action. And we need to see this from people our age. I wish I would have known refugee educator Mohamed Al-Junde from Syria, tree planter and entrepreneur Felix Finkbeiner from Germany, or gender equality activist Faisim Anjuntak from Indonesia when I was 12 years old. And I wish that I could have been able to jump on a call with them and share ideas and experiences. Now, I have to add that with the rise in youth engagement, a new scary trend has also set in. The best way to describe it is maybe to refer to the word greenwashing. You all know it. It's the process of conveying a false impression about the climate friendliness of a company product or actions. What I see happening a lot at the moment is something I would call youth washing. You don't want to know the emails and approaches we get on a daily basis from companies that want to use us for anything that sounds good or just to tick off a box. Associating one's brand with youth climate activists seems to be good for business, although the intention rarely extends to being good for climate too. So, to the company's youth washing, I want to say, instead of inviting youth for the photo ops and the applause, offer us a seat during the brainstorming meetings, during the internal workshops with no audience. Maybe invite us to one of your board meetings and ask us for some reverse mentoring sessions. You might be surprised. I look back at the last 10 years and see an intense journey from a young, cute girl to a change maker. For the next decade, I see a whole generation that is rising, leading by example and taking action. Youth activism is more than an inspiration. We are serious about change. Thank you.
So we have with us today two Buddhist monks who have traveled to be here and to be part of COP26, to be here in Glasgow. They're both followers of the Zen master Thich Nhat Hanh, and I'm delighted to welcome them to the stage for a conversation now. Brother Phap Dung and Brother Spirit, please come up and join me. So come take a seat, and thank you very much. Thank you very much for being here. I know you are having actually a pretty intense time. You start your mornings with meditations and people are gathering with you early morning. You're just being here, kind of absorbing the energy and spending time with people. I'd just like to ask, what are you picking up? What would you say about the spiritual energy here, Brother Phap Dung?
I see people are very caught in their head and they're rushing around. So what we're offering here is a little bit a slower pace. When we walk here, it's like very surreal. People are like rushing by,
right?
And they're not fully present. I think that's part of the, that needs to be part of the discussion, the culture that we have that's rushing. So in the morning we have meditation at 8 o'clock, and these different team members come and they sit with us, and we see that they need to really be cared for emotionally as well as bodily. There's a lot of tension, so we've seen. They're feeding back and it's helping. So I think that human element, taking care of the people doing negotiation, the behind the scene, is a very crucial element. Because only through that will you have a real openness and real dialogue. So I think that's the part that we're adding to the picture, taking care of the activist, the politician, the negotiator.
Right.
So this is, we see that that's missing here. I think people, when they're full, they're stressed, it's very hard to listen and to be open.
And for the people joining us by video, this is a very big space. There are thousands of people here, all kind of working with real purpose. Now you two stand out. It's not easy to miss you, right? By your beautiful robes. And I wonder, are people stopping you in the corridor, Brother Spirit? What's that experience like?
Yes, so very frequently people stop us, and their first question usually is, what are you doing? What are you doing here? So we like to ask another question, which is, well, why don't we start with, who are we?
Right.
And that sort of stops them in their tracks, and then, and where are we? And where are we going? And sometimes they ask us today, somebody asked us, what's your business? And we said, well, our business is businesslessness.
Right.
No business.
The business of no business. And that really stops people. So then we have a chance to have a conversation. So I want to echo as well some of the things my brother Taifab Jung was saying about caring for the change makers, because we see that as really an essential part of what we can offer. And very often, what happens is somebody sits down with us and they're curious, they want to find out what we're here about. And within about 10 seconds, they're crying.
Right.
This has happened so many times that it starts to be a little bit spooky, you know, like, what, are we just making everybody cry? What's happening?
Right.
But it's because everybody is at their limit of what they can tolerate. They're under so much strain just to get into the space. There's so much stress to get to your session on time, and you don't have the logistical support and so on and so forth, but especially at the emotional level.
Right.
As we just heard from Melati, we know that for anybody working in this space, there's pain. We're faced with pain, with frustration, with despair. And so we see it as absolutely essential to talk about that and to talk about actually how we can handle that. So it's not about covering it up or denying it or making it go away, but it's how to metabolize that pain, that suffering, that sorrow. And the good news for us is that actually we have the technology, the spiritual technology.
Right.
And we've had it for a very long time. And to me, it's extraordinary that somehow as a species, we've kind of lost touch with it. So I think actually every culture, every tradition has these kinds of methods. And so, you know, we as Zen Buddhist monks, we just want to offer our little piece, and every tradition should offer its part. But that's what we are very, very, I feel grateful actually every day, because what I see is that it's very simple to help, and what we have works.
Right.
Like I said, within a few seconds, we can take somebody from kind of holding themselves together. They're very put together. You know, everybody knows how to put on a good face and keep it all together. Within a few seconds, they break, you know, and they're crying. But then we can help them to become softer, to be okay with the pain, to know how to handle it skillfully, to know how to embrace it with love, so that it can become the fuel for our continued engagement. And also, like Melati was saying, knowing how to help people to rest, even just for a few breaths.
Right.
Like right now, every one of us sitting here, you know, we're all carrying some level of burden, some level of strain. And just with a few words, we can remember that Mother Earth is under our feet. We can, it's not imaginary, you can feel it. The mind is so powerful, we can remember this beautiful planet floating in space, supporting us, offering us her stability. We can take a breath, we can let our shoulders drop. And it's just a few seconds, but it changes how we feel. It changes what we can do. It changes how we show up to the work, to the meetings, to the difficult interactions. And, you know, so I'm very motivated by that. And just today, you know, we saw the wonderful youth march for Fridays for Future.
Yeah, I wanted to ask you about, because we're talking in a way about what's going on inside here.
Yeah.
And maybe a surprising facet to part of what's going on inside here. And then today you got out on the street with some of the community who've shown up. And it would be wonderful. I don't know what people are seeing on the media in terms of what's going on. But it'd be wonderful if you could just bring to life, both of you, what you experienced today on the streets.
Yeah, we've been spending since the first day being in here, the zone here, offering and being part of different discussion. And my brother and I knew we had to do this, so we took our bikes and we were riding back. And we're on our way back, we met this mass of children, families, grandparents playing music. It was an energy of joy.
Right.
I think what I felt was like, wow, this is how to express concern and maybe anger, to translate that energy to joy. There was like mothers and babies. I counted like at least 20 babies on father's shoulders, and it was just, and music. And I wanted to bring some of that in here, because I think what's missing sometimes is a little bit of joy as well. As we do this, it gets intense. And I think of the courts in the old days, maybe, where there's like a musician's coming in and playing and having a little break from all this intensity of information, because you get so overloaded. And when we saw them, we wanted to go home and rest, but we stayed longer than we planned, because it's not about rest, it's about being nourished. And seeing this mother in front of me taking her baby, who was barely learning how to walk, and I saw the baby, and there was no fear. Usually that intensity, and there was drumming and everything, and every baby that I saw, there was no crying or, you know, with a lot of people.
Right.
But I recognized that every child there was not fearful. They felt safe. That's pretty amazing for that energy. So you see, even the baby was being nourished. And I think that's the spirit, the human spirit that we're lacking.
Right.
As we look to solve real problems, we also need to bring in joy, the wonders, and translate anger and all that stuff into this other energy that moves and inspires. So we have to be careful as activists and scientists and politicians, and to be careful as we, because it's toxic too.
Right.
When we actually are overloading people, and this is what we're experiencing with a lot of youth that come to our monastery. A lot of activists from the XR movement came to our monastery ready to quit, and they revived themselves and found new inspiration. So this is, for me, what we felt this afternoon, and it gave us energy to be here. And we wanted to share that, to let that be, have a voice and have a place, because it's scary to, that's, that energy is scary for the, you know, the desk and the suits. But this is very needed, I think, in as we evolve and try to solve this together.
I wonder if we can talk a little bit about the journey that we're all on as human beings, this journey, if you like, of growth and of transformation, and of how we raise consciousness. I know that, I believe that you would say, certainly I would say, that without a raising of our individual and collective consciousness, we can't actually tackle problems of the scale of climate change. And I wonder what you'd say to people in terms of how we engage in that journey, that lifelong journey. What would be your guidance, Brother Spirit?
Thank you. Thank you for that question, which is very central for us. What I think we're seeing here as well is that it's, you know, it's natural to approach the problem as a problem of measurement and information and solutions, and sometimes techno-solutionism. Of course, we need all of those things. It's not to dismiss any of that. We really know that we have to rely on the science. That's the base. But for us, it's important to combine all of that information, that sort of head world, with heart, with love, and with a different relationship to who we are, who we believe we are, and what we think our life is and what this world is. Is it mere stuff?
Right.
Is it matter just to be extracted and used? You know, for us, it's kind of like, even if we solved the climate crisis, even if we keep heating to 1.5 degrees, even if we stop emitting greenhouse gases, for us, that's not enough, actually. I don't want to add another problem to everybody's plate, but actually, I think this is part of the solution, which is looking at our relationship with Mother Earth, our relationship to ourselves, and bringing in a spiritual dimension, a dimension of reverence, of love, of looking at how we look at each other. Like, of course, in a climate conference like this, there's an element of wanting to maintain order. So the protests have been kept at a very safe, so-called safe distance. But for me, that's coming out of fear.
Right.
And I think we have to trust. We have to trust the love of the youth, of the whole world, of all of humanity, the love of life, of our planet, of the living world. And we have to let that in. So not just to use our heads, but to allow ourselves to be motivated, guided, fueled by love. Because if we're only fueled by the profit motive, you know, because we, you know, we say, oh, trust the markets, you know, we'll be able to flip around with the race to zero. We'll make the companies compete each other. Compete against each other to get to carbon zero. We use competition to get to where we need to go. And that's fine as far as it goes.
Right.
But even if we achieve success, it's a kind of success that may be toxic, actually. Toxic to us as human beings, if we're always competing and struggling. So what we want to say is there's other energies that can drive us. Compassion, love, generosity, inclusiveness, spirit. And those things will never be toxic. They can grow infinitely. Love can always grow.
Right.
You know, you can become a victim of your success, but you can't become a victim of love.
So let me ask you finally, you're both also engaged in the pain of all of this and presumably also have times when you maybe feel overwhelmed or a sense of despair. So perhaps you could each just give us one practice, something that's important to you in terms of how you tap into your own sense of hope and love.
Yeah, our practice is to come back and to follow our breath. So the technique, the technology of retraining ourselves is through the breath. And when we're aware of our breath, we breathe in, we recognize we're alive. Breathe out, we relax our body. It's very simple, everyone does it. You know, when you come home to the house and you put your luggage down, you sit down, you kind of go, you're doing exactly that. And so that technology is not specifically belong, everyone has that. So it's that ability to just rest and be present with the moment and not in our head of thinking. So that actually, slowly you find some rest, some healing in the body, and it will have, you'll realize things. So from stopping, you will see something. So that is the basic formula. When we slow down, we stop, our mind is clearer, and we can see, wow, I've come home. My loved one is here. I recognize my children. I recognize my partner. I recognize myself. So that love is not something ephemeral, and it's very tangible, and you can feel it, and you can train that. And when someone is content in that way with their life, they're content with their loved ones, their relationship, it has a print effect on emission and consumption and the culture. That's the human activity that we're not calculating.
Right.
We're calculating all this stuff because it's easy to measure.
Yes, yes.
But I think I would love people to measure what happens after a person goes to a retreat and they change their direction, they change their diet, they change the way they move in the city and their commitment to inspire. So that has,
right,
Katharine was sharing, that beautiful way of emitting good stuff.
And a final thought from you, Brother Spirit, then.
Thank you. I think one of the things that I can tap into at any moment is my sense of connectedness. So we all get interdependence, right? Interdependence now, I think, is well understood, especially in the climate movement. If you've studied any kind of, science, you know that we're all completely inextricably interconnected. But what I'd like to propose is that we start to find practical ways to take that from a kind of intellectual, yes, I get it, to a felt experience of deep interconnection and what we would call non-self, or more than self. So despite the fact that we get it intellectually, I think we're still operating within a paradigm of separation, right, fundamentally. And if we stay in that paradigm, we're just going to reproduce the same kind of system that has given rise to the current crisis. So this is critical for us. So to give an example, like, I'm sitting here, but I'm not alone. What you see here is just the sort of, it's like the fruit body of the mycelial network. You just see the mushroom, but underneath there's a vast network. So for me, I can connect instantly with my brothers and sisters back home, hundreds of them. We're just the tip of the branch, and behind us is the tree, the roots, the rhizome, and the ancestors. So that's in space. You know, with all of the natural systems that support us, I'm not just human. I'm the trees. Mm. I'm the living biosphere, and we all are. So that's in space, but also in time, in the access of time. I can connect and ask for support from my parents. Mm. You know, they're here with me now. I can ask for support from all my ancestors, all the way back through the lineage, human and non-human. I can ask for support from my teacher and from his teacher and the whole lineage of practitioners who have cultivated love and wisdom over thousands of years. And that's actually what permits us to be here and to keep our freshness and to keep our love and to help us when it gets hard. And we can tap into that. Anybody can tap into that. It's not difficult, but we need to think about how we can spread that knowledge, spread that, share that technology. Like Melati was saying, we could have an hour a day mandated for every school child of environmental awareness, education. But maybe 5 or 10 minutes of that hour should be how to take care of yourself, how to take care of your feelings, how to take care of each other, because we can't do this alone. We have to be a community, and that community has to be meaningful community, where we can really offer each other the kind of support that we need.
Thank you, brothers. Thank you for being here with us tonight, and thank you for being present at COP26 and for all that you're doing.
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay.
Thank you. So to end, I want to share a 3-minute video. Today was Youth Day at COP, and in the Pacific, there is a young country, the Republic of Palau. It's just 27 years old. Young country, but already threatened by climate change. Sea levels are rising and more. Just about a month ago, they celebrated the 27th anniversary. In 2017, the Palauans establish an original, powerful, insightful, inspiring eco-promise in the name of their youth. And so we've asked some children of Palau to tell us about it. Let's watch.
Ali from Palau, my beautiful island home in the Western Pacific Ocean. We Palauans have been here for over 3,000 years, living in harmony with nature in our pristine paradise environment. Palau is home to just 20,000 people, but we are a large ocean state with more than 300 islands covering an area the size of France. Some of our islands are coral atolls, others are volcanic, covered with hills and ancient forests and mangroves, all with beautiful beaches bordering the crystal clear sea, which is alive with incredible rare marine life.
But our home is not threatened by climate change. The climate crisis is causing sea levels to rise and bring so much pollution to our shores. Plastics drift in from thousands of miles away, washing up on our beaches, threatening our marine life. Our precious soil is being washed away by increased rain. And in other seasons, new droughts are having a terrible impact on our fragile ecosystems. We warmly welcome visitors who come to our beautiful country every year. We want them to enjoy Palau, but we need their help to protect our precious home and preserve it for future generations. But visitors don't always know how to protect Palau. They don't understand that stepping on coral can badly damage our reefs. Some corals take hundreds of years to regrow. They are sometimes careless and take protected species or interact with nature in harmful ways.
That's why we introduced the Palau Pledge. When visitors come to Palau, they must all sign an environmental pledge, which is stamped into their passport as their visa. The pledge is a promise to the children of Palau to preserve and respect our home, our culture, and heritage. We also hope that when they return home, visitors will share the idea of the pledge by practicing it at home and in their community. Through our traditional chants, our elders have passed on that we do not inherit the land and waters from our ancestors. We borrow them from our children. That's what the Palau Pledge is about. And here it is.
Children of Palau, I take this pledge as your guest to preserve and protect your beautiful and unique island home.
I vow to tread lightly, act kindly, and explore mindfully.
I shall not take what is not given. I shall not harm what does not harm me. The only footprints I shall leave are those that will wash away.
The only footprints I shall leave are those that will wash away. It's kind of a first principle for everything we're doing here. In a way. So thank you for coming, for staying until the end of the day. Another session tomorrow, Lindsay.
Yeah, thank you. And thank you to all those who've joined us on the live stream. We will be back here same time tomorrow for a final TED Countdown session. Thank you, everybody.
Good night. Thank you.